people who are not anxious at all. That means there's not even that little concern about how things should be. They're generally bored in life. You will find these guys saying, I'm so bored. I'm so bored. And you wonder, what is there to be bored? There's so much to do in life. But here, that's that. The other side, very high fear, extreme tension. Those are the ones who are extremely unhappy, because no matter what they achieve, it's at a cost which is very high. It's either physical illnesses that come in because they stress too much in terms of performance, and I have to do it, and it's too much fear, too much pressure. The moment you have too much pressure, how well will you perform? If you're very tensed, extremely fearful, how well will you perform? Of course, efficiency will go down. In fact, anybody who has a stage fright over here? Okay. When you have a stage fright and you're on stage and you're really scared, what can happen?
You
can forget what you want to say. The exact task you came for, you'll muddle up. Because too anxious. Now, a certain optimum level of, I won't say fear, but concern about what you're doing would be needed if you want to perform at your optimum. Not just perform at a task, but just live in a more fruitful manner. You need that little bit. So if you look at all of these things, tensions, fears, anxiety, when it's in that negative mode, this is how we would describe it. It's a strong negative affect, affect meaning emotion, bodily symptoms of tension, in which you apprehensively anticipate some future danger, some future misfortune. What if, you know, this could go wrong, that could go wrong, what if this happens, what if that happens? There's a lot of speculation, and you anticipate that something will go wrong. Now, you tell me, if I'm in a state like this, what will happen to me? You're right at that. Surely I won't be able to talk, because negative affect, so the anxiety is really mounting. Bodily symptoms of tension. What exactly are these bodily symptoms? Any idea? What happens when you're nervous?
Acidity.
Okay, acidity, headaches.
You can make out from the face that this man stands.
Surely. What goes wrong with the face? What happens? It changes?
Yes.
How does it change? There's no smile for sure.
No,
what
smile.
Else?
There's something we can make out with this person.
Yeah, you can make out nervousness. Sorry? Yes. So often knees get wobbly. You know, you feel like you're going to fall. There's choking sensation, irritable bowel syndrome. You know, people feel like running to the loo, ghadi ghadi. It's happening. It happens because of these bodily tensions. Tell me, there are various effects of worrying. Forget what the slide says. You tell me. When we worry, what happens? I'm going to stop this.
Power goes down.
Okay, resistance power goes down. When you say resistance, you mean your immunity? Surely. Your immunity goes down, because of which you'll catch infections very fast.
Yes.
Okay, anything else? Yes?
You
can't put in... Now what? Okay, you can't put in your best effort because you're not all there. You know, when you're anxious, where's your mind?
Wandering.
Wandering, but where? Absolutely. The moment you're anxious, are you in the present moment?
No.
Where have you gone?
Future.
Now, if I'm in the future while I'm here, how will I perform this? It'll obviously go for a toss because I'm not even here. I'm in the future. There's no way I can do something well. Sorry?
Or in the past,
yes. So often our mind goes here and there only, no? Either past or future. We have no other station to go to. So often we wanted to stay in the present, but so difficult. Alright, some other things, as you have rightly mentioned, yes, your immunity does go down, therefore physical illnesses. Eating and sleep problems. Do you find yourself or others whom you've seen, when they worry too much, either they sleep too much or too little? Does that ever happen?
Yeah,
some people eat too much or too little. And generally when you're worried, what do you eat?
Just
Everything that you shouldn't be eating. So you'll eat sweet, you'll eat fried. These two are favorites when it comes to anxiety and tension.
Why is it so?
Comfort food. Comfort food. Plus sweets more because you know your brain sugar levels go lower. Just before, when you're feeling anxious at the beginning. After that they rise. So actually speaking, you're not supposed to. You shouldn't be, you know, eating sweets at this time.
They are,
but more than mood elevators, they are mind elevators. It just feels comfortable. You know, generally people who are eating too much, why are they eating? Because they have an appetite.
No.
Why are we eating? We are somewhere eating to fill a void. You know, you feel a certain emptiness because of some problem or something, and you want to fill that. And so often it's with food. By the way, in psychology, we've always related food with love, nurturance, affection. Because as a baby, how does a mother show nurturance towards the child? Feeding, right? So food is associated with love, nurturance, affection. So therefore it's comfort zone. When you're eating, you feel good, you feel full. It's that same feeling. Alcoholism, drug abuse, even suicidal ideations. A lot of people, when they feel hopeless, you know, where they get into this helpless state, there's nothing I can do to change the situation. That kind of thinking, that will lead to suicidal ideations. You know, I will never take someone, but you know what, I will never take someone who says I'm suicidal lightly, because you never know. You never know. I can't say that. I can't say that. You know, I feel it's not right to take it lightly, because how do you know? We can't predict, and I'd rather not take a chance than take a chance. You know what I mean? Not really. The rates are much higher. They really are. The ones who are not committing suicide, they're just trying or saying it. It's a call for help. It's a call for help. So I cannot take it lightly either ways. Because if this is happening, that means there is something going amiss and the person feels helpless. The person doesn't know how to deal with it. All the more reason I will pay attention to someone like that, so that doesn't get here. Emotional disturbances. When we say emotional disturbances, we mean all the negative emotions, but intense, like anxiety, like anger, like guilt, shame, you know, things like that. All of those. Lowered concentration, attention. Like I said, if your mind is in the past or the future, how will you concentrate on what's going on? Memory problems. Why memory problems? Generally, I've seen people under tension, memory goes for a toss. For important things, and you feel like, how could I forget this? You know, that kind of stuff. Why does that happen? Mind is cluttered, okay. If the mind is cluttered, yes, you're not going to be able to have access to information. True. Any other reason? You were saying something? Mind is disturbed, yeah, similar, because you're somewhere else, you know. Another thing is, say for example, if I asked you, what did I say in the past 5-10 minutes that have gone past? If you were here, you would be able to tell me. But if your attention concentration was not here, it was somewhere in the past or in the future, then you can't tell me anything that happened here. Somebody else will think bad memory. Actually, it's not that. You didn't pay attention only. How will it form a memory? To form a memory of something, you have to pay attention to it. Even that hasn't happened. So often it's that. And of course, gul milake, you will have decreased productivity, enjoyment. It just saps your energy. Okay, now why does all this happen? Why is it that our immunity goes down? Why is it that all this rubbish starts happening? Why?
It affects you physically and emotionally.
Uh-huh.
Worrying affects.
Okay, worrying affects you. She's absolutely right. Worrying affects you physically, behaviorally. Let's quickly see what it does to you. I'm not getting into scientific details here, but I just want you to know what exactly happens when you start worrying. Is it okay if I erase this?
Yeah.
Thank you. You know what's on the board? Technically, it's called an HPA axis. Nothing to worry about. The moment you're tensed, the moment you're worried, the moment you're anxious, there's something called the hypothalamus in our brain. It's a small little thing, okay? The smaller it is, the worse it is, because it has a lot of implications on your emotional health. This gets triggered, gets chubby. So the moment you get tense, the moment you get anxious, now when is it that you will get anxious? When you interpret anything in your environment as threatening. Threatening to your survival, threatening to your self-esteem, things like that. So the moment that thought even comes, the hypothalamus in your brain, what they've shown over there, starts getting activated. Once this gets activated, it sends a signal to what is called a pituitary gland. That's again a very small gland, but that also gets activated. Once this gets activated, it sends a signal to what is called the adrenal gland, which is just above your kidneys. Not that you need to know any of these details, but the point is, the moment the adrenal gland here gets activated, gets turbid, what does it do? It does a horrible thing. It punishes you. It actually releases what is called cortisol. I don't know if you've heard of this hormone, but it's not a bad hormone per se. It's a hormone we all need if you want to have action, any kind of action. But you already have good enough cortisol in your body, you don't need more. And now it is releasing more. The moment this hormone is released, what happens to you? You get into fight or flight mode. What is fight or flight mode? Any idea? Yeah, you either face the crisis or you run away from it. Now, absolutely. Now, problem is, this cortisol now readies your body for fight or running away. Why? Because in primitive times, we were cavemen. Yeah? Yes or no? Yeah, we were. Now, when we were cavemen, who were our threats?
Tigers.
Yeah, tigers, lions, other tribes, all of that. So, what did you need for fight or flight? Energy, because you either needed to bash up someone or you needed to run away depending on the samne wala ka strength, right? That's exactly what your bodies do even now. That hasn't changed. So the moment this is released, your body has tremendous energy to either fight or to run away. And therefore you will find when you feel really anxious and tensed, you know, you find a certain restlessness. Would you see that in people? What do people do when they are restless?
Unnecessarily
they are walking fast, talking fast. Some of them, you know, that tuck 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 people do with their legs. I don't know how they do it. It's not easy, huh? But that happens. What else?